New technology has come to the mining sector in the shape of a company that does machine learning, and it's bought into Blue Jay Mining, which stock has seen a big leap. We'll take a look at Blue Jay shares in just a few moments' time, but I want to introduce our guest to discuss this and take a look in some more detail about what it means to the mining sector. It's John Mayer from SP Angel. John, welcome. We've spoken a lot about the mining sector over the last several years, of course, but we haven't really touched on how new technology is beginning to shape the way in which these companies operate. And we've seen this deal recently. This is a company which is, I think, partly owned or founded, at least, by Bill Gates and Jeff Bezos, the Microsoft and Amazon founders. And I know they've got a big interest in this. Clearly, this is a new dimension, I think, for the mining sector, isn't it? Because of technologies now, which are beginning to be used in this sector. What is it that's happened at Blue Jay?
Well, we've seen Silicon Valley dominate technology in certain areas of life. And now these very clever guys have moved into the mining sector, and what they're looking for is large-scale, valuable deposits for battery metals, particularly battery metals for the new range of electric vehicles to come out. And they've identified Blue Jay as holding licenses in Greenland that are of significant interest to them. So Dr. Peter Lightfoot, who's one of the leading geologists at Cobalt Metals, he's working there with Dave Broughton, who's another geologist who's made major discoveries in the world, particularly in copper. And these guys are working with the smart guys out of Silicon Valley to bring together their geological expertise, use the artificial intelligence and machine learning, pull it all together, examine the geophysical data and the geology that's been done on the ground to identify where the copper and the nickel targets really are on these license areas. And Dr. Peter Lightfoot formerly worked for Falconbridge on this project in Greenland. He's very excited about it. He thinks that they will identify something of quite large scale. What it's important to understand that this is a pretty large area in Greenland, and Greenland's a little bit more difficult to explore than many other areas because of the short exploration season. You don't want to be there in the middle of winter when winter closes in. But $18 million has already been spent on work in this area. It's not easy to drill, but the rewards are likely to be enormous when or if they find something.
Okay, let me just break in there if I can and take a look at the share price chart. And I think at this time it's the right thing to do to say that I know SP Angel, Blue Jay is a client, I believe, of SP Angel. Is that correct? And I also believe an extra element to this is that I believe also you are an individual shareholder. Is that correct? What do you see in Blue Jay?
Well, I bought my shares in Blue Jay a few months ago. And the reason for that is I really like the Dundas ilmenite project up in the north of Greenland. That's a world-class project for production of titanium mineral sands. It's large scale. I spent a lot of time looking at the quality of these mineral sands, and that's all important. So the impurity levels are low, the grade is very high, and the economics for me stack up. And I actually think this is worth more than even Blue Jay management think it's worth. But that's my personal opinion, and that's why I bought the shares. I also like the rest of the project portfolio. So not only is there the Dundas project, which Cobalt Metals are bought into and are spending $15 million on, but there's also the projects in Finland where Rio Tinto has come in on a joint venture. And they recently also joint ventured another nickel project in Finland, very close to the Talvivaara mining project, with a group called Metals One. So there's a lot going on with Blue Jay. And in fact, they're attracting some very, very big players into partnering with them on the exploration.
It's interesting, actually, reading down the list of interested parties here, I also see that Cobalt Metals, there's also Michael Bloomberg's got an interest in it, SoftBank chairman Mayashi Son through an investment vehicle. So there's some really big names behind Cobalt Metals. I'd be interested certainly to find out what else they're doing in this particular area of the market. But let's ask you the question about new technology and the mining sector. How can the mining sector benefit from new tech? We've been talking here about a special machine learning and artificial intelligence. What is it that they're doing, and what is it they can do in the future, ultimately, I guess, potentially to mitigate the cost base for these mining companies that are finding increasingly costly to get minerals out of the ground?
Well, I'm sure cobalt metals are not the first people to try this, but I think they're the first really serious group to try it, which is very well backed. This, in fact, is their first joint venture with a mining company. So we don't have a lot of precedents to go on right now. But as the way I see it is, there's a lot more data than there ever used to be to feed into these computer systems. It's now possible to start to program a computer with the geophysical and geological data that's being collected on the ground and pull together a much clearer picture of what is going on underneath the ground. So this is a particularly unique area in Greenland. It's close to plate tectonics. It's got high magnesium and olivine-rich magmas of 2 to 5 kilometers thickness. Its proximity to large crustal scale faults. There's a lot of sulfide and sulfur-bearing country rocks, very important for creating a source of nickel and copper. Prolonged episodes of assimilation of siliceous crustal rocks here, contaminated lavas containing shales and sandstones, also chalcopyrite elements depleted in crustal contaminated rocks. So there's a lot that these geologists are getting quite excited about. And these are the sorts of things that they've seen elsewhere in the world where they've discovered lots of copper, lots of nickel. So Norilsk Nickel, Sudbury in Canada, these other very, very rich discoveries that have been made have similar sorts of hallmarks. So this is why cobalt are focusing on this, because it's a difficult place to explore, but the reward is potentially very great.
That's from the corporate point of view. How about from the metals pricing point of view? Does it affect the price of the metal ultimately out of the ground? In other words, if you trade, let's say, copper or nickel or one of the new battery metals we're talking about here, particularly with cobalt, is it going to depress the price of those metals? Is it easier to get it out of the ground and cheaper?
No, I don't think so, because you're not actually going to develop this for a good few years. The market is looking really rather short on the key battery metals. We've seen the prices now being offered to buy lithium jumping in the week. We saw a major lithium company in Australia, Pilbara Lithium, announce a much higher price than what we've been seeing in the market for an auction of lithium concentrates last week. So we see this new demand coming through because there's so many battery gigafactories and megafactories coming online, and they're all desperate for the feedstock to make those batteries with. And it's not just in China, but it's elsewhere around the world. We're seeing a lot of announcements almost on a daily basis of people either building new factories or expanding the factories. And they need good quality raw materials.
You mentioned China. Let's just pick up on another news item that's come through recently, and that is electric vehicles in China. We know that there's a pickup in electric vehicles, generally electric vehicle sales, despite the fact in the last few days, I know that we've seen a bit of a drop in Tesla sales in China. But I think overall, Chinese electric vehicles sales are going up and up. I guess, obviously, this is what we're all having now to engage with, and we should expect this. Any thoughts on what we've seen from China recently from you?
Well, electric vehicle sales rose 164% year on year in July, and that's 271,000 electric vehicles sold in China. Now, that's battery, mainly battery vehicles. There might be a few hydrogen fuel cells in there, but I would have thought 99.9% of those are battery or maybe some hybrids in there as well. For me, it's the pure EVs that are the way to go. I'm not really sure why anyone would want to carry around a petrol engine in a battery driven car these days. Yeah. Although China saw an overall drop in vehicle sales in July, they did see this massive increase in electric vehicles. So that's telling you that consumers are very keen to go this way. They recognize the huge cost savings from using electricity rather than buying petrol or diesel. And of course, the ride quality is very good too. So consumers have really gripped this idea, and they're running with it. I mean, who wants to buy an old diesel vehicle these days?
I was going to ask you, have you adopted electric vehicles? I know you're have had obviously petrol vehicles in the past, and are you adopting new technology now?
I'm waiting for my historic vehicles, and I'll describe them as historic to die. I don't have anything that's less than 14 years old in my fleet. When they do die, I'll be replacing them with battery vehicles.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Okay. All right, John, look, we'll leave it there. But thanks indeed for joining us. John Mayer from SP Angel, taking us through that new initiative with the Bujay Mining in the mining sector. For more videos from us here at IGTV, join us on Twitter at IGCom, Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel.